Hello and welcome to the next lecture in Bio110. This lecture is going to be part of the material that we'll be covering in week 11, and it's going to be concerning signal transduction. It's going to be the first part of the signal transduction series. So in the next couple of slides, I have all the objectives that I would like you to achieve during this chapter. This is actually an extensive chapter looking at multiple different molecules and how they are tasked about sending communication from the outside of the cell to the inside of the cell. So in the first slide, you have the first set of objectives that I would like you to look at. On the second slide, you have the second set of objectives that I would like you to see. And on the third slide, you have the last and third set of objectives. Each of these is going to be attached to one of the lectures coming up, and therefore you don't have to attain all these objectives with the first lecture, but you're going to have them from all three lectures that are going to be used during this time. Now, let's take a look at one of the main and principal purposes of the cell. As we discussed earlier when we were learning about membranes, the membrane, it is an organelle that is used for communication. Now, communication in a cell doesn't happen in the same way that we can say about, for example, a cell phone. I'm using this particular figure because it has the old-fashioned cell phone that used to be the rave when the original book came up. So the new book has an iPhone, and I thought that was pretty actually amusing. But anyway, going back to this, remember that the extracellular signals are happening outside of the cell. And those extracellular signals need to then be communicated to the nucleus, so some kind of phenotype will happen. So just in the same way that we have radio signals going inside the antenna of our cell phone, and those radio signals then are translated into sound, chemical signals that are occurring outside of the cell are going to be received by molecules and receptors on the membrane of the cell, or inside the cell for that matter, and those will then be translated into a signal that is going to mediate an effect on the cell. What we're going to be looking in this chapter 16 are all the ways in which, at least an overview of the ways in which the cell can understand and then translate signal to get a phenotype. So one of the things that we'll need to see, it's the difference in temporal stages that signal transduction can happen in the cell. So what we have in this image is an extracellular signal molecule that is going to bind to its receptor. And once it's bound to the receptor on the surface of the cell is able to initiate a signal. On the left-hand side of this image, we have now an intracellular signaling pathway. And that intracellular signaling pathway is going to result in some level of altered protein function, meaning that a protein that is already existing in the cell, sort of like a kinase, but is present in the cell but inactive, will be somehow modified, for example, by adding a phosphate group to it, that will now turn it from a molecule that is off to a molecule that is on. And that altered protein will now gain its function and then perform a function in the cell. That was going to lead you to an altered cytoplasmic machinery, let's say the cytoskeleton moving, and then that is going to lead you to an altered cell behavior, like movement. Because you are modifying proteins that are already made, but those proteins are maintained in an inactive state, these side of the events are happening very quickly. They could happen within seconds to minutes. And therefore, the cells are able to respond very fast to the signal. On the other hand, you can have signals that are going to lead to transcription of genes in the nucleus. Those will create RNAs, and those RNAs will then be exported from the nucleus to the cytoplasm, where they will create a protein. Now, you have changed the gene expression by making a new protein that wasn't present before the signal was given, and that protein now, the process of translation and the process of transcription, excuse me, and then translation, it's going to take time, particularly to get a sufficient amount of protein to be effective in altering function. Once you get a critical mass of the proteins that are being generated, those then can then alter the cytoplasmic machinery, let's say the cytoskeleton in another way, and then those molecules that have been changed by the newly expressed protein result in an altered cell behavior. Because you need to have activation of transcription plus translation. All those events are going to take a lot more time, so they can happen between minutes to hours. And therefore, when we're looking at the difference in signal transduction, we can have some very fast events which result from modifying existing proteins, or some slower events which will require RNA transcription, translation into new proteins, and then getting sufficient proteins to perform the function. Now, different signals can affect one cell, and the effect that those signals can have in the cell will depend on the combination of those signals and how the signals are interpreted by the cell. For example, in this image we have a cell that is receiving three different signals, signal A, B, and C. The combined effect of those three signals is going to give that cell a survival signal, and therefore that cell will continue living. Now, another cell, it's going to receive the same signals, A, B, and C, but this one also receives signals D and E. And therefore, now, the new addition of those two signals from, could be a protein or a hormone, like a steric hormone, so that new signal together with the previous one are going to now have a brand new phenotype. Instead of indicating the cells to survive, now this is going to turn the cells on to divide and grow. Switching to other signals, for example, now instead of receiving signal D and F, you have now F and G, will then have a different effect on the cell. And in this case, the cell will be turned to differentiate. Last but not least, either receiving of a completely different signal or a lack of signal altogether may signal the cell to die, and that cell will die by apoptosis. And apoptosis, it's programmed cell death, a genetic program that gets activated to commit cellular suicide. So as you can see, the different signals may have different phenotypes when the cell interprets that information. And one important factor that needs to occur is the cell having the receptors for all those signals. So you can then differentiate the way that the signals are giving by the expression of the receptors that are found on the surface of the cell. So what you have here, it's the example of how one signal could be interpreted differently by the receptors found on the target cell. And this is an example of acetylcholine. When we look at the acetylcholine receptor, the one that we already learned in class, we're looking at skeletal muscle contraction. And what we had, shown here in C, is the acetylcholine molecule binding to a ligand-specific channel, and when that ligand-specific channel binds to acetylcholine, that being the acetylcholine receptor, that channel opened and rushed sodium ions inside the cell, and that led to the contraction of the muscle cell. But there are other acetylcholine receptors present in different cells. For example, heart pacemaker cells have a different kind of acetylcholine receptor, and this one, it is not a channel. It is actually a 7-transmembrane GTP binding protein. So when the acetylcholine molecule binds to the heart pacemaker cell, you're going to change the way that the cell fires. So a normal cell may be firing with a particular frequency, and once acetylcholine binds to the acetylcholine receptor in heart pacemaker cells, the cell it will experience a decrease in the rate of firing. Other cells, like salivary gland cells, will have a similar acetylcholine receptor, but however, these cells will be triggered to secrete salival proteins when acetylcholine binds to them. So as you can appreciate from this image, the same neurotransmitter being bound by different receptors result in different phenotypes by the cells who have them. So this is a way in which the same signal can induce different phenotypes depending on the receptors that the cell has, but not only the receptors, because you could also be the program that receptor can control within a different cell. Now, let's think about ways in which cells can communicate. And the first way in which a signal can be communicated, it's from a long distance. And sending molecules at a long distance is considered the endocrine pathway. For example, in this image, what we have is a cell that is releasing a hormone. That hormone will go through the bloodstream, and eventually it will reach its target cells. But in an endocrine system, the hormone always has to travel through some kind of circulatory pathway to get to a target cell that is tissues away. Another kind of signal is considered the paracrine signal. And the paracrine signal now involves cells which are within the same tissue, and you have a signaling cell that is releasing a signal in its environment, and cells surrounding that cell with a receptor that can recognize the local mediator will then bind to it and affect a different response. As we learned already earlier about neuronal signals, the neuronal signals are able to receive a signal, for example, from a neuron, and that signal can be translated into an electrical signal that eventually will lead to the release of vesicles containing neurotransmitters. So whenever you think about neuronal signals, it's always by the release of a neurotransmitter to a cell through that has the neurotransmitter receptor, and therefore it will initiate, for example, a depolarization of the membrane of the target cell to initiate another action potential. The last communication is going to be the contact dependent. You're going to have a signaling cell and you're going to have a targeting cell. The signaling cell is going to have a membrane-bound ligand on its surface. That membrane-bound ligand can now interact with a receptor on a neighboring cell, giving that cell a signal to, for example, differentiate. One last example of communication that is not shown in the slide, it is called the autocrine signal. This is related to the paracrine, in which you have a signaling cell, but that cell also has the receptor for the local mediator that is releasing. So basically, you have a cell that is turning itself on. One of those examples is going to be the interleukin 2 cytokine and the interleukin 2 receptor. T cells have the interleukin 2 receptor on their surface, and when stimulated, they will secrete interleukin 2, turning themselves on to divide and become an effector cell. So that will be the autocrine signal. So again, to summarize, you have five different kinds of signals. The endocrine signal that requires movement of a hormone through, for example, the bloodstream. B, paracrine, where a cell can release a soluble mediator to the environment that will be picked up by cells with a receptor in the same tissue. A neuronal signal, when you have a neuron having a synapse with a target cell, and then you have the release of neurotransmitters. And the contact-dependent signal, where a cell with a ligand is able to stimulate another cell with its receptor. The example of that is going to be the notch and delta ligand sample. And last is the autocrine signaling, which the cell can release the local mediator, but that cell also has the receptor for it, so the cell turns its cells on. Now, let's take a look at some of the receptors and ligands that we are going to study today. So we have receptors, and receptors in general are transmembrane or intracellular proteins that can bind to specific ligands. Usually, a receptor will be specific for a ligand, though some receptors are able to be promiscuous and bind multiple ligands. However, be a specific or a promiscuous receptor, the effect is going to be the same. One ligand is bound to that receptor is able to convert that signal into a cellular response. And some of those receptors are going to be extracellular, but other ones are going to be intracellular. Now, the ligand is going to be the signal. That signal could be a soluble protein, like a cytokine, or a sterile molecule, like a hormone, like cholesterol-derived corticosteroids, or it could be another protein in the surface of another cell that is going to bind to the receptor in an adjacent cell. But the ligand is going to be the signal that is going to turn the cell with that receptor to perform a function. That cellular response, and always, Always, a cell is not able to respond to a ligand if it doesn't have a receptor that is specific for that ligand. Let me give you an example of the contact-dependent signaling. Here on the left, we have unspecified epithelial cells, and those cells are going to go through a phase of cell specialization and lateral inhibition. So the cell in the middle will begin to express a molecule called delta. Delta is a membrane-bound inhibitory protein. The cells surrounded the one in the middle are now, because of specialization, express a different protein, and that protein is going to be the notch ligand. So the cell in the middle is going to now be able to give a cell-to-cell signal to the surrounding cells that contain the notch receptor, and the one in the middle will be developed into a nerve cell, and the ones in the outside will be inhibited epithelial cells. So in that way, you have now the developing of a neural cell in the middle that is going to be able to inhibit the developing of neurons around it by expressing the delta protein. Now, other ligands are able to bind receptors that are inside the cell. So in the image here on the left, I have an example of a small hydrophobic signal molecule that could be cortisol, for example, or any of the cortical steroids derived from cholesterol. It could be a sexual hormone like testosterone, and those are able to diffuse readily across the membrane, and then they are able to find a receptor inside the cytoplasm, or sometimes the nucleus, and therefore exercise a function. Other ones, like the one shown here on the right, the example in the right is the toll-like receptor 9, or TLR9 for short. TLR9 is a receptor for foreign viral RNA that is present inside a cell. So when a virus infects a cell, and that virus has an RNA genome, the toll-like receptor 9 molecule is able to bind to that foreign viral RNA, and it will elucidate a signal transduction cascade that can result either in the upregulation of pro-inflammatory cytokines, therefore launching an immune response, or it can turn on the interferon response genes, which are going to help that cell become a target to immune cells and therefore be destroyed. But the thing about toll-like receptor 9 is that it's present in vesicles within the cell. It's not a receptor that is found on the outside of the cell. So it's another example of a receptor that is inside the cell and not on the cell membrane. Now, the sterol hormones are another example of intracellular ligands that can diffuse freely across the cell membrane and bind to the receptors inside the cell. All of them are going to be derivative or cholesterol, so cortisol, estradiol, and testosterone. Also, sterol hormone is thyroxine, which is released by the thyroid gland. So as you can see, the structure of these molecules, at least cortisol, estradiol, and testosterone, they are derivatives of cholesterol. But these molecules are not as hydrophobic as cholesterol. For example, estradiol has two hydroxyl groups, whereas cholesterol only has one, and it has lost the long amphipathic tail that cholesterol has. So therefore, this molecule, though it will be carried in the circulation by a protein, once the protein reaches the target cell, it will be able to release it, and the estradiol will be able to move across the plasma membrane of the cell and into the cytoplasm. So in this case, we have an example of cortisol. And cortisol is considered a stress hormone because it goes up during times of stress. So cortical release around the target cell will cross the membrane. And once it crosses the membrane, it's going to bind to the cortisol intracellular receptor protein. That is going to induce a conformational chain in the protein receptor. Now, because of that conformational chain, this intracellular receptor protein that was sequestered primarily in the cytoplasm is able then to move to the nucleus. Once it moves into the nucleus, it's able then to bind to regulatory regions on target genes that it can recognize. It becomes now a transcription factor, and therefore it can activate the expression of those target genes And those genes, for example, in the case of cortisol, could be genes involved in carbohydrate or fat metabolism. But because of the fact that the receptor is in the cytoplasm and is inactive in the absence of cortisol, when cortisol can cross the membrane and the receptor binds to it, it induces that conformational chain, and immediately that receptor cortisol complex can move into the nucleus to induce transcription of genes. So in that regard, it is a very effective way to turn on gene expression. Now, another intracellular ligand, it's going to be nitric oxide. And nitric oxide, as we know, is a gas. So it's going to be a very local mediator. So now, let me begin by describing where nitrous oxide is going to be effective. And nitrous oxide is going to be effective around a blood vessel. So around the blood vessel, as you can appreciate, you have a basal lamina. This is an epithelial layer, so you have an endothelial cell that is tightly bound to the basal lamina, and adjacent to it, you have a smooth muscle cell. So you have only a very small separation by the basal lamina, which is extracellular matrix, connecting both the smooth muscle of the vessel to the endothelial cell. Now, in this case, we have acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is going to be released in the epithelial cell, so it's going to be released, and acetylcholine binding to the 7-transmembrane acetylcholine receptor, it's going to turn on a set of events that will eventually lead to the activation of a protein called the nitric oxide synthase, or NOS. Now, the nitric oxide synthase, when it becomes activated after acetylcholine signaling, it's going to take arginine, and it will catalyze the reaction to produce nitric oxide. Nitrous oxide is a gas. It can diffuse freely across the cell membrane, and therefore it can be released from the endothelial cells, cross the membrane, and reach the smooth muscle cell. When nitric oxide diffuses across the cell membrane into the smooth muscle cell, it will bind to a receptor, and in that receptor, it's a guanylyl cyclase. The guanylyl cyclase that is bound now to nitric oxide will become active, and that enzyme is able to mediate the reaction converting GTP into cyclic GMP. Now, cyclic GMP is going to induce the relaxation of the smooth muscle. And by inducing relaxation, then the blood vessel can relax and allow more flow of blood through it. So again, a signal binding at the acetylcholine receptor in the membrane of the endothelial cell will activate the nitric oxide synthase, which is going to mediate the reaction and produce nitric oxide from arginine. Nitric oxide can diffuse freely across the membrane of the endothelial cell and cross the basal lamina until it reaches the smooth muscle cell. Inside the smooth muscle cell, the nitric oxide can bind the guanylyl cyclase, and guanylyl cyclase will generate cyclic AMP from GTP. Cyclic GMP then will be able to induce the relaxation of the smooth muscle. Let me show you in a moment how that works. So now, I want you to think and apply your knowledge. What is the mechanism of muscle contraction, and how may nitric oxide promote muscle relaxation? So think about those events while you're looking at the next slide. When the smooth muscle relax, that is going to induce the blood vessel dilation, which is going to allow for more blood flow to go in. Medically speaking, this has a lot of advantages, and let me show you now how that works. For example, in this case, we're looking at the events that are occurring in the smooth muscle cell. So, for example, either a neuron or endothelial cell, it's going to get the signal to generate nitric oxide. Nitric oxide will diffuse across the membrane to the target cell, and it will bind to the guanylyl cyclase, and the guanylyl cyclase is going to be able to convert GTP into cyclic GMP. Now, cyclic GMP can bind to the protein kinase G, shown over here. And protein kinase G, being a kinase, is able to use ATP to phosphorylate a target protein. In that case, that phosphorylated target protein can lower then the amount of calcium free in the cytoplasm, and that is going to induce the relaxation of the vascular smooth muscle, which is going to allow for more blood flow. In that also regard, you can have the cyclic GMP be converted into non-cyclic GMP by the essence of the protein PDE5. Now, sildenafil, it is the scientific name for the drug Viagra. And that compound is able then to inhibit the PDE5. By inhibiting PDE5, you do not get conversion of cyclic GMP into regular GMP, and therefore you have an excess of cyclic GMP, which can activate protein kinase G, which eventually lowers the concentration of calcium within the cell, allowing for blood flow. That is the mechanism in which the drug Viagra can help people with erectile dysfunction by increasing the blood flow. When you look at the way that cyclic GMP induces smooth muscle relaxation, think about it this way. Number one, you're going to have the increase of cyclic GMP, which eventually leads for an inhibition of calcium entry into the cell, and that decreases the concentration of intracellular calcium in the cell. That is also going to activate potassium channels, which are going to also lead to the hyperpolarization of the muscle cell, and therefore the muscle cells cannot contract, and that is going to maintain relaxation. But also, it's going to stimulate the GMP-dependent protein kinase, which is the protein kinase G that I was telling you about. And that protein kinase G can also work to activate the myosin light chain phosphatase. The myosin light chain phosphatase is an enzyme that is able to remove phosphate away from myosin light chains, and therefore lead also to smooth muscle relaxation, which increases the blood flow in the area desired. So in that way, the secondary method, cyclic GMP, is able to have an effect in the cell after the nitrous oxide, which is now the signal being generated by one cell into the other one, diffuses across the membrane to activate it. Last but not least, let's take a look at some of the cell surface receptors. And here we're going to be looking at some of the ones that are going to be extracellular. So what you have in this image is an example of a cell surface receptor shown here in green, and you have some extracellular signal molecule shown here in red, and when the extracellular ligand molecule bind the receptor, you're going to induce some signal transduction shown here by these black arrows that will turn on an intracellular signaling molecule and therefore induce a phenotype in the cell. Now, some of these receptors are going to initiate response within the cell. And what this image is showing, it's a receptor that is bound to the ligand. The ligand is red and the receptor is green. And you will have a sequence of events turning on different effector molecules. Those are the ones that we're going to call the intracellular signal molecules, or secondary messages. Now, when those secondary messages activate effector proteins, some of them may, for example, affect metabolism. Other ones can affect the cytoskeleton, which result in cell shape or movement. And other ones are going to activate transcription factors, which will lead to gene expression. So depending on the intracellular molecules that are triggered by the receptor, you may have different effector proteins that will be activated that will lead to different cell responses. One of this, for example, is shown here. You have an intracellular signal molecule, you have its receptor, and in the way you have a relay. The relay are the different molecules, could be proteins in this case, and those proteins are maintained together by a scaffold to allow the signal to come down really quickly and transduce a signal that could then be amplified. Amplification is one of the important components of signal transduction, because the amplified signal is able to take a very low amount of extracellular signal molecule and increase the response to that through the receptor by increasing the number of secondary messengers. So that is going to evoke a large intracellular response. So you're going to have the transduction and amplification of the signal. And that is through the generation of the small intracellular message molecules, for example, calcium or cyclic GMP. At the end, what you're going to have is the integration of multiple signals that could converge into a particular pathway. And then, once they converge into that pathway, you can have distribution, which is going to turn on the effector proteins. And again, the effector proteins, depending on which effector protein gets turned on, it can result in altered metabolism, changes in cytoskeletal shape and movement, or the turning on or turning off or gene expression. For example, here we have a rod cell, and this cell, in the outer segment, it has disc of photoreactive membrane containing rhodopsin. Those are the cells in our eyes that are going to receive signals from light. And then in the inner segment of the cell is where you have the mitochondria and other signaling, other components of the cell. The nucleus is going to be at the bottom, and at the end you have a synaptic region, and the synaptic region is going to send neurotransmitters to activate the signal to the brain. Now, on the right, what we have is the amplification of signal when we have, for example, one photon of light hit one rhodopsin molecule in the outer segment of the rod cell. So you have one rhodopsin molecule absorbing a photon. That rhodopsin molecule is going to be able to turn on 500 G proteins, which are going to be activated. In this case, those are called transducings. It doesn't matter. But those 500 G proteins themselves are going to be able to turn on another 500 cyclic GMP phosphodiesterases, which are going to be activated. Notice now the change in the shape of the arrow. Because of the result of those 500 cyclic GMP phosphodiesterase activation, now you have 10 to the 5 cyclic GMP molecules that are going to be hydrolyzed. That is going to lead to the 250 cation channels in the plasma membrane of the cell being closed, which is going to prevent between 1 million to 10 million sodium ions per second to enter the cell for a period of about a second. That is going to have a dramatic change in membrane potential. Remember, sodium ions are coming in, are going to elucidate a signal response. So now when you close all those sodium ions, you're going to alter the membrane potential of the cell. And when the membrane potential of that cell changes by about 1 millivolt, which is a significant amount of molecule, you get that signal relayed to the brain. So one photon of light, it's able to activate one rhodopsin molecule that could activate and enhance the signal by modifying 500 G proteins. We're going to learn about G proteins in a moment, or in the next lecture, actually. But what I want you to see is that the system has an amplification pathway that is able to take a very little amount of input, in this case, one photon of light, and enhance it to prevent 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 7 sodium ions from flowing into the cell. And that change in sodium ions across the cell will have a signaling event on the brain cell. Now, the amplification cascade is going to be one of the general principles that we are going to learn in signal transduction. So I want you to be aware of when the amplification cascade is happening and how it is happening. And it's going to happen differently according to the activation molecules present. So now, earlier in lecture, I'd show you a slide in which you can have an altered protein function. Basically, the fast signaling when you have already a pre-made protein that just get modified. And by being modified, now you have an altered phenotype. Here in this slide, what I have to show you are the two ways in which proteins can be modified. And we call these molecular switches because we basically have them either on an off state or an on state. On the left, in part A, we have a protein, and that protein is off. That off protein, by a signal that is received from the outside, is going to be phosphorylated by a protein kinase. And now that phosphorylated protein has been giving the on signal. That on signal is now turned on that protein, and therefore that protein can perform its function. when you have now a protein phosphatase, which is going to be able to remove the phosphate away from the protein, that protein is turned back off. This system can also work in inverse. The protein could be off if you have an inhibitory phosphate present on it, and then the protein phosphatase can remove that inhibitory phosphate, turning the molecule on again. And therefore, the protein without the phosphate is now active. Then a protein kinase can be able to phosphorylate the protein, shutting it off. So in this example here, the phosphorylation of the protein leads to the on phenotype, but I also want you to remember that phosphorylation may be also used to turn a protein off. So the molecular switch can happen both ways. Either the phosphate turns the protein off, or the phosphate present is able to switch the protein off. On the right, we have now a different kind of molecular switch, and that depends on the presence of the nucleotide GTP. So we have proteins that bind GTP, and when they are bound by GTP, those proteins become activated, and therefore they're able to perform their function and produce a signal. But when GTP is hydrolyzed to GDP, the GDP bound version of the protein is now inactive. That protein will only become active when you have an exchange of GDP for GTP, that is usually mediated by what is called a guanine exchange protein. So a guanine exchange protein is able to take the GDP from the off protein, remove it, and help put a GTP on it, and now that GTP-bound protein is active and is able to perform its function. Once GTP is hydrolyzed, then the protein becomes inactive again. So the signaling by GTP-binding proteins is going to be very important as a way to turn off or turn on signals. So therefore, the mediation of the presence of GTP to the inactive form will be able to turn the protein on. So that's going to be a good way to regulate protein function. I believe that this is the last slide in the lecture, and that's where I'm going to stop. So watch this lecture today, and hopefully we're going to have a very good discussion on Monday. Thank you very much.